switch right now. One of our speakers is unfortunately stuck in horrific traffic. So I'd now like to bring up the design team, Baby Imperial and Damien Ahn, from BNC Design. And if you go outside afterwards, there's an absolutely gorgeous Chibet book that they designed, and Ringo Benon, who was the moderator of the first panel, was the editor of this incredible book that is a piece of art in and of itself. So if I could just ask the two of you to come up. Baby Imperial and Damien Ahn explore the intersection of communications, design, and visual arts, combining their capabilities in two, three, and four-dimensional spheres of graphic design, communications, interior design, and visual arts. Coco Damien Ahn received his education from the... Oh, right, I can't speak French. Coco, from the academic... Never mind. Anyway, for visual communications, graphic design, and photography. His work in painting has been exhibited in the Grand Palace, Paris, France, twice at the Salon... From collections of private individuals. This is why everybody needs to learn more than one language, like myself. Okay. Baby and Ancien. Ancien Imperial received her education from Parsons School of Design for graphic and advertising design and interior design. Furniture and lighting fixtures projects are in the collections of private individuals. They guide a communications and design practice BNC. They've also been engaged as visual artists for public art installations at BGC Parks, the Edsa Boysen Project, and at the Nielsen Tower, Ayala Triangle. They are the Jack and Jill of all trades and master of none. Can I please introduce Baby and Damien?
I'm going to stand here because my assistant, Coco, who is really actually the brains of everything, is going to help me with the presentation. First, I'd like to thank, and by the way, the name of the school was Académie Charpentier, and he was exposed, he was exhibited at the Grand Palais in Paris in the Salon des Jeunes Artistes. Angel, you get that? Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to PWU and to Angel for allowing us to be part of this very exciting project of Angel. We are so pleased to be part of something that deeply impassions us. Don't worry, Angel, I'll try to keep it short since it impassions us. I also have a story like Kenneth. When I was young, my parents come from Bicol, from Albay, which was really the home of Abaca. So every summer, though I grew up in Manila, we would go home and we would frolic about with coconut trees, weaving, and making all sorts of things with Abaca. And I was so, that encouraged me to be very crafty at that time. And of course, going to school, like Patrice said, actually, where we had to learn embroidery, ganchillo, we have to learn many macrame. I did so many macrame gifts, dog collars in the 70s for my sisters and all that. So this, well, I thought that I was going to, you know, that was what was going to make me part of the creative industry. Meanwhile, my partner in crime, Coco, was growing up in a theater. His father was the theater director of a national theater in Paris. And of course, many years later, we try to get to our love story. So we are intoxicated by art. We are intoxicated by design. and I think herein lies the crux. Do we need to know art to be designers? Are art and design converging? Can art help us evolve into better designers? Can design, in fact, now be considered art? Globally, in the Philippine context. Well, we have good news and bad news. First, the good news is we've assembled many different types of images for you to appreciate on these topics. The bad news is you will have to be the ones to decide. To start, I guess we can go through a cursory sort of go-to list of what falls under the visual arts, you know, the traditional way, but now everything's shifting. But traditionally, visual arts were drawing, painting, sculpture, architecture, photography, film, printmaking. Then there was what was called the decorative arts, ceramics, furniture, interior design, jewelry making, metal crafting, woodworking. Then there were the so-called applied arts, so many arts, so little time. Fashion design, graphic design, and so on. Many different categorizations. Sometimes they would call different arts commercial arts. But what is commercial? I mean, even Michelangelo and the Dutch painters were paid by patrons to put out art, so that was commercial. There's also, of course, installation art, as Josephine has shared with us, with her beautiful work, performance art. It really is quite amazing. So we will go through the images that we put together, Coco and I. You will have to pardon that it's all a mix, actually, from Western European art to Filipino art. So assembling art, architecture, design, and craft, as we all know, is not new. It even started in the medieval guilds. Only the ideology changes. There are many examples of movements and collectives that form what I guess I would call creative melting pots. And I think that is what we want to show you here and how art and design are linked. From the arts and crafts, so this is not in chronology actually, we just wanted to show how everything, we are hoping that you will appreciate what the connections are. From the arts and crafts movement, who brought art and the idea of craftsmanship to protest against the industrialization of the 19th century, to the complete opposite, the Bauhaus school, who brought all of the above together as well, but were opposed, in fact, to any form of ornamentation, and were proponents of art and industry technology to produce artifacts for mass consumption. They were about public good. They were movements and ideologies. They started this collectives because they had an ideology, not just to make aesthetically good-looking products, but because they were doing it because they were part of a movement. In Vienna, you had the secessionists, in Holland, the Stiel. So here we will be showing you slides of a very small choice of art and design collectives and movements and examples up to contemporary times and how they all referenced each other. They will not be in chronological order, as I mentioned, for you to appreciate for yourselves the convergence of the things that you perceive for yourself. So this first thing, I guess most of you should know, will know who know it, is by Piet Mondrian. It's the Boogie Boogie. He was part of the founder of the Stiel movement, together with Theo van Doesburg. And basically, it was about reducing things to the most abstract form, because it was supposed to appreciate the spirituality of nature. If you were here earlier, Amihan Lim had shown the work of ethno-linguistic groups who derive their inspiration and their mysticism and their myths from nature, from the from how nature, the order in nature and everything is because of the simplicity that we can see. Next slide. So that's detail. So they were about very pure shapes and very vertical and horizontal lines. It was called the, he called it the new plastic art. There was no perspective and no representation to just appreciate the energy from nature. This then was applied to furniture by Ritwell. And, oh sorry, first East and Lahom. And we're gonna jump to the 1970s. So from the 1920s, I mean, this is just to show the 1920s to the 1970s, East and Lahom was inspired by Pierre Mondrian and started to apply these abstractions to shapes of dresses. But in the 1920s as well, Ritwell, a furniture designer who was part of the Dishkio movement, created I think it's called blue, red. There was everything was blue. They all used primary colors for the Dishkio movement. So it was an ideology that they used on architecture also to build a new society. There was always this expression of an idea behind it. There was always a sort of an exploration and a questioning. Then we move on to Bauhaus, I think. I'm not sure if it's Bauhaus. Oh no. So this is actually all of the different elements of how the Ritwell chair was assembled. And next slide. I don't know what the next slide is. So many artists were afterwards either part of this movement, thought of the Bauhaus, were inspired by this. This is Malevich. And as you can see, he again uses abstraction. Yeah, Malevich for same Malevich. And of course, oh sorry, I forgot to mention that we are communication designers. And so the graphic quality and all of this, of course, is very strong and speaks to us very strongly. Thanks. And this is furniture by Donald Judd. Donald Judd, who was a proponent of the minimalist movement in the 1960s, 70s, and apart from making paintings, he did furniture and installations. So he uses the very primary colors as well, and the very abstracted shapes. These are still Donald Judd. I love Donald Judd. The simplicity of the form and the line is very compelling. Still Donald Judd. Oh wait, so this is Mike Rothko. This is Mike Rothko, who was also inspired by the Dishkio movement. And of course, he painted this also very abstracted shapes. Okay. So I think this was an exhibit. We pulled this obviously off the internet, but I mean this from a book of ours. And of course, in this particular exhibit, I don't know which one it was, you see the juxtaposition of the Boogie Boogie and Mike Rothko painting. These are more Mike Rothko. These are, what? Constructivism, right? Which was a kind of a parallel movement that happened during that era in Russia. Actually, there is, I think, a story that Tatlin, who started constructivism, visited Picasso and saw all of his assemblage work, and that's how he started to get interested in that. So from painting and furniture, we now move into a more graphic applications, which were political in nature, of course. The Bauhaus was as well a parallel movement, and all of this was about ideologies of how to change the world, to make society better, and using art and architecture and design. So as we can see here, we see these very simplified forms in architecture. Graphically treated. Next. So interestingly, so now we insert the work of one of the most iconographic artists of the Philippines, 20th century of the Philippines, Chabet. who was the father of conceptual art here in the Philippines. And as you can see, he uses, again, planes, he uses primary colors. Next slide. I'm not going to explain the thing. I think Ringo should come up here and explain Chabet's work. So he used planes and colors in a very minimalist manner. Here he is, this is a collage. So there is, we see the collage is also a form of assemblage, is a form of collage and vice versa. So this is art. Next. Here he uses the primary colors of the Dishkio movement. And we now go to an American, so that was in Europe, Philippines, now we're in America. This is the work of Barbara Kruger, who uses very strong graphic treatments in making statements that she imposes on an environment. She uses sans serif style, which was actually developed by the Bauhaus group in keeping with their wish to simplify things and have no ornamentation. So now she uses typographical treatments for her art statements that are imposed on whole environments. Thanks. This is Picasso. This is like a test, Coco. I'm supposed to guess who it is. This is Picasso. This is one of his sculptures. Again, I guess it's Picasso. These are assemblage works. Okay. And the reason why we show all this assemblage is we move now to a group, another collective called Droog Design, which is a Dutch collective, and which started work at, I think, about early 80s to 90s. This is a work called Tree Trunk by Jurgen Bay. And here, I think we move into the area where, is this a piece of furniture or is this a piece of art? This was made by Jurgen Bay for a town that borders Germany, where a Dutch princess married a German prince. So there's a lot of history. So it's almost like a exploration of that history and the context of where this piece of furniture, art, whatever, design art you want to call it, is based. The trees come from that area, and you will see that there are different backrests that come from different periods in decorative arts that he has put into the trunk. So this now is a form of seating, but we can question many different things about it, whether it's functional, whether it can be distributed, shipped. So there are many different ways we can look at this piece. But he references assemblage work from the 1920s. This is who? Jurgen Bay? John or Judd? Strike three and I'm out. They're going to throw me out of here. I won't say who it was. This is also very interesting. This is now a German group of furniture designers that it was in the 80s. This is Frank Steiner, I think was his name, where he repurposes ready-made objects. So this is a what do you call it? Shopping cart there, which he repurposed to become a chair, but it has other messages and other meanings. I think the name is called consumer chair. So here again, we move into this area of what constitutes art design and is art related to design and vice versa. This is a chest of drawers. I'm not sure if it's by Jurgen Bay, is it? Yeah. Yeah. This is Piet Eyck, whatever his name was, another Dutch designer who uses found objects. All of these things like found objects, ready-mades, all that, these are all traditionally art terms that were used, that were propagated, with the start of modern design to contemporary. And now this is contemporary furniture. Thanks. This chair I love. This is a chair by a postmodern furniture designer called Alessandro Mendini. And the history of this chair is that he was he had finished reading a book by Proust, during Proust's time, these were types of chairs that were there. So he found a ready-made chair, an ornate, ready-made, whatever chair, and decided to apply the pointedest technique of the Impressionists on the chair itself to create another layer of meaning. So that's and from there we will move into Louis Cordero's art, which can be hung on walls, but then also become ping pong tables, which also question the role of art and all that, but have a functional objective to it. To our traditional cultures, and which I said earlier that Amina had talked about, which have a relation to the Adishtio movement that wanted to simplify, to go into the spirituality of nature, to the mystical energies and create balance and all that. To the secessionists, this is Gustav Klimt, and of course this was also referencing nature and the shapes and forms of nature, and of course the furniture that was applied during that period in the same movement. And then we have a so in all of the examples projected, the design objects, as you see, were designed, quote unquote, design objects were designed drawing from art concepts, methods of art making, the idea of ready-made assemblage, the movements of Dadaism, Surrealism, the idea of repurposing or presenting an existing object as another object. And basically, if we were to say it, art is universal. So I'm not, I think that, and whether it's Philippine art or art elsewhere, if art is universal, everybody speaks the same language. And if art is used in the service of design, it is referenced for design or vice versa, then there seems to be some kind of convergence. There's the artisanal processes as well, the craft making, the technique, the repetition, the complexity of the work, which are all part of processes for art making. The myths and the dreams that they emerge from, the reflection of nature and the order that we see from it, the patterns, the weavings, primitivism. So in our practice, we explore these intersections, communications, design, because art communicates, furniture, anything actually communicates. In this day and age of cell phones, everything now communicates, is transparent, is accessible. So art and visual literacy and the continuous process of expanding it is deeply embedded in our process. We deal with shape and form, with color, with texture, with space, volume, mass, and dimension. We use this to express ideas. Some artifacts that are produced have a function, some do not, and simply express an idea. Here we have a work of Gary. This was a collaboration with Gary Ross Pastana in a park in BGC, where we redefined the landscape. He recreated, but they have a functional objective. These are also used as a running track. And the tree is artificial, but helps generate helps clean the air. This is the way Bulgaria was, Pastrana. On the other side, we have a repurposed telephone poles. Now, the utility poles were first put in the beginning of the 20th century when there was the American-Filipino war. These are now serve no purpose because everything in BGC is underneath. So we decided to recreate a new landscape and engage the way people interact with telephone poles by creating an installation that that works like a landscape in a way, as opposed to being upright. But apart from that, there are also exercise poles and benches for seating. Now the name of this piece is called Pole Position, which is a kind of a tongue-in-cheek reference to who is ahead now. Because this was Fort McKinley, which is now BGC, was an American base during the Filipino-American War. So. I wanted to end this presentation by talking about how Philippine art and design is burgeoning. Our culture is incredibly rich, rooted in our diverse cultures. I think we have over 70, if Marian were here, Marian Pastor, she'd kill me if I don't have the right number of the ethno-linguistic tribes. So I would like to end it by saying, does art change how we can use this wealth of diverse cultures? Will it open our minds in new directions, engender a world of ideas, question, evolve, contribute? Will seeing art and design as intrinsically linked make better design, better designers, and ultimately better citizens for not only of the Philippines, but of the world? I humbly hope that our little presentation will help you determine the answers to these questions. Thank you.
Wow, this is nice and diverse. I'm wondering if I should open the question to the floor first. Are there industrial design or fine art and interior design students here right now? Wow, okay. Yes.
Hi everyone. Well, before anything else, it is our pleasure to have you as our speakers today. This question is for all the speakers. What are the things or activities that you usually do to boost your creativity or productivity? Is it something that is timely or is it something that you have to plan to focus in order for you to create designs or ideas?
Various ways of entering a design or artistic process. But for me, it comes from everywhere, right? Sometimes you can't sleep anymore because you're imagining and you're trying to make a design or trying to solve an artistic problem, and work never stops. Inspiration comes from different many different elements in our life. Before I thought inspiration will come one day, you know, this is like the students, when I was still a student, oh, one day the inspiration will come. The idea is to have the problem in the back of your mind always.
So design is a discipline. So I usually devote a time for it, a fixed time, so you say maybe half an hour where you just come up with things, and sometimes it comes, sometimes it doesn't, but that's part of it. But the important thing is to stick to that certain time of that you plan. Design is no different from like a sport, you know, or dance or anything. You gotta keep on doing it.
Yeah, design also involves a lot of research, so it's basically what we do all the time. We research a lot, and sometimes we have a real idea of what's going to come out of the research. It's really the part that's the creative part for us. We can learn a lot, we can see a lot of different things.
Because I failed to mention earlier that why for us it's important to research and to sort of have this visual literacy is so that the more you know and see things, the more connections you can make. Kenneth was talking about seeing in a blade of grass or things like that, but even in a blade of grass, I remember a poem by Umar Khayyam. So it's all these different things in your head because of all the different things you absorb and try to keep in, that you start making connections, and out of those connections, you start expressing ideas in design and in art.
Thank you so much for bringing up research, all of you. I think it's something that people tend to fear or don't quite know, well, what is research? And especially for those of us that are in the arts. So just as a follow-up to this, I'm curious because all of you have been either partially educated abroad or entirely and then have come back to your home countries, whereas you have decided that you love the Philippines. So, do you think that your educations abroad in some ways have influenced how you research and the work that you're doing? Is there a difference for you to be in terms of being educated in part here and then in Europe or in the United States?
I didn't tell my story earlier in Canada. I thought that I was going to be going to art school, to UB, to the University of the Philippines, which was very prestigious at that time to go there. But of course my father, like Kenneth's father, didn't allow me, but for different reasons. It was because I was a woke girl, right? And at that time, I was supposed to go to a co-ed school, and it was very radicalized at that time. So, I persisted in my crafts, and my father finally allowed me to go to school abroad. I feel that because like Kenneth, went away from my culture and was brought into another culture, where the methods of teaching the resources that were available helped to push me to be more inquisitive and, in fact, to pursue more explorations and research. I think that was very important. And I think that, at least I see it with Coco, actually, also, his education in France. Whereas I picked it up when I went abroad, but it was something that I had to work at very hard. But I think Coco educated in a French system where the preservation of culture and art and patrimony is very important. I'll let him talk about it.
In the French education, we start very early with art, and we have a lot of exposure to media or music or painting, theater. So that's what brings a lot into the, if you want to be an artist or a designer, it brings a lot to your background. it helps also to have a bigger resume, maybe, and you can get a score with a wider knowledge.
Well, living abroad definitely helps, not only in education, but also just by being abroad. But basically, it was different for me because I was selling furniture for people abroad, and I didn't know how they live. I couldn't sell furniture to them. So for that basic reason. But I wonder if it's true also for art. And I'd like to know whether this is something that's only for design, because I'm trying to sell something, and it's important to know how the rest of the world lives and what's out there. I don't know if it's the same for art, so maybe Josephine.
Well, the question was if research is the same here or abroad. I mean, by experience, there's no difference. It's just that when I went for my studies abroad, I was in Paris and I speak to the French people and they say, "Oh, France is the best country in the world." And then I said, "Oh, okay." And then I go to Germany and say, "Oh, Germany is the best country in the world. The Germans are the best." And then I go to Italy, "Oh, Italy is the best country in the world." And then all of a sudden I started asking, "Where am I from?" And then that's when the idea of really going back to my history dawned on me, and which is very important. So I would say, in a way, the trips abroad, the exposure also brings you back to your homeland. Research, I think it's the same. You do research here as well as there. There, maybe they have more institutional support, but we're a creative race and people, so we make things work. We're resourceful.
Okay. Let's clap for that. Okay, one question from the audience, and then we're going to take a little snack break.
Good afternoon, I'm so glad to be seeing very good speakers around here. There's one person I'd like to quote, President Obama. He said climate change, he said something about climate change. He said we have to take climate change as an opportunity. So with art and design, I was just wondering, how does it affect art and design to you? Climate change. Taking it as an opportunity.
We can always get from current events inspiration at the same time, connected to our practice. For the arts, for my practice and climate change, I would take I would do video. Actually, I'm doing a video on it with underwater shots of migration of the animals, the pelagic fish, and this is an idea of tackling climate change as well. In any current event, for me, I can connect it to my work in any way. Climate change also, if I'm doing jewelry, I would say I'd use materials that are sustainable instead of using acids in metals. You know, that's what I will start looking into that. So that's how I would apply climate change to my work.
Rather than by climate change, I think you're trying to ask how do we slow down the effects of climate change with our work? And rather than state the obvious, of course, where we use natural materials and sustainable processes. I think in design, everything that we make in the Philippines is generally environmentally friendly because it's usually handmade, so there's very little emissions. It's not done on a machine. We don't have heavy industry really producing the things that we make. And the second thing is, I just try to make whatever I do, whatever I design, as well made as possible so that people keep it. I always ask my students, you know, why is a Louis Vuitton bag, even if it's made of PVC, you know, environmentally friendly? And I say, have you ever seen somebody throw a Louis Vuitton bag? Okay. So I ask the opposite, that when we make things very, very well, in order for future generations to treasure, you know, I think that's the best way to slow down climate change.
Kenneth, I'm actually not throwing away that Louis Vuitton bag because of that. It must be the price. Anyway, well, in our practice, same thing, like what Justin and Kenneth said, it's obviously trying to be sustainable, especially as communication designers with paper and all that and the processes. But I think as Kenneth said, it's also, I guess, design thinking. When you think in a certain way on how you can do something, if you try and maximize the resources, you're already helping towards that. For keeping things like architecture, furniture, objects, it's the same thing, that you want people to keep it because it will be adaptable. And as I guess visual artists out there, to create works that make people question and understand the issues that are around us, one of which is climate change.
To Mr. Covetwork, we as a student and you as an inspiration, how do you deal with plagiarism and it's hard to be unique. How do you deal with copy-paste and plagiarism designs?
How do I deal with counterfeiters and
piracy?
And pirates. I shoot them. Now we go after them. So we protect all our designs, and we go after them aggressively. In fact, you've seen in the news, we've gone after a lot of them. You know, and even if you go to the road now, you know, on the way to Tagaytay, you don't see it anymore on display. You know, it's in their catalogs. You can ask them for it. But you know, it's a step. They don't show it anymore. And how do I monitor? Actually, friends who pass by tell me if they're there. And it's been on the news. We go after them. And I think at any time we have 3 to 4 cases in the courts. You know, and most of them have actually settled. We've settled almost all of them. They don't want to go through the litigation process. And, so that's it.
I was going to ask if you guys want to have a little thing with each other.
I have a question for Kenneth. When when this whole notion of what would it really call design happened in the mid-century design, or even before that, it was because the whole thing was to produce beautiful objects that were for public good, that many people could enjoy them. I think everybody knows now, like the people, that you know the price of design objects are quite elevated. So, is that still a concern for designers in terms of providing well-designed objects for a greater public?
That's a very good question, and I make no pretense about it that. Because my things are made in the Philippines, I can't really cater to the mass market. We've just everything that we make here is expensive because we are an expensive country. You know, when we make things, our labor, from our labor laws to our power, our things are not made in China where it's run on a machine, it's an assembly line. You know, in fact, most of the things that are cheap are made in China. And so in order for me to produce things for everybody, I'd have to pay my workers below minimum wage, I'd have to use child labor, you know. And so I tell everyone that as long as I have to make a choice, that as long as I produce my things proudly in the Philippines, made very, very, you know, well-made stuff from here, then I have to be expensive. There's no other way.
Hello, Mr. Ben Kabuntwe. This question is for you. Yeah. I want to ask you, what really drives you to keep doing what you do? Of course, there's money, fame, fortune, but what really inside, you know, that hits you in the head and keeps you doing what you do? Thank you.
I think I only have the fame. The fortune's in there. No, it started out with a passion, basically. And the whole reason why I'm probably, there are a lot of very brilliant and talented designers in the Philippines, and probably the reason why you know me is because I insisted to put my name on every piece early on. But that was because I just wanted to be respected as a designer, as an artist in the world. And I wanted to be known for my designs. It was natural then for people to just take things from third world countries and just label them under their own names because, you know, we're just a manufacturing country. And that's why I changed all that. Now I think it's different. You know, before, of course, I wanted to make money, and everything that I made, you know, the whole branding exercise was all about selling more furniture. But now it's different. And I see that probably more important than any of my work is the inspiration that it gives to young people like you. More, I think that's probably more important than my entire work, you know, this legacy of paving the path for future designers and future brands and future companies in the Filipino creative industry to come up and shine in the world, showcasing the best of our country. Thank you.
That we evaded the intersection of art and design, and if we evaded it or we skipped it. But maybe I'd like to ask the designers here, do you think art is the umbrella of art and design, or is design the umbrella of art and design, or is there no such thing between a separation of art and design? And the second question is, well, for Coco, as a foreigner, how would you, but of course adopted country here, how do you think with regarding the situation in the world now? I've been to Italy recently and they're bankrupt. I mean, low economy. Spain is also has very problems with labor. Portugal is forgotten. And so, do you think that also for the younger people in the audience, that what's the hope for the Philippines? And what do you see? Because you're a very the partnerships you have, you also, maybe as a Filipino, who's also been around.
Well,
the answer,
now, the Philippines is, I think, is going to boom even more than what it is now. And, a big place. A big hole.
strategy in order to improve your production.
The intersection of art and design. Yeah, that was the question I was posing to them after the presentation. Well, I think personally, Coco and I agree because we have very strong art education backgrounds that this knowledge, this reference to art and the art movements has really expanded the way we design. And I think it is intrinsic to the way that we design. I don't know if it's the umbrella, but I think that art and design are converging in many ways, as I showed in the presentation. Where, and I think the group of Linko, Gary, you know, they also, I think in the last, that was not the last art fair, but the art fair before, Mo had a table full of design objects that were done by artists. So there's definitely a convergence there. So for us, as Jack and Jill of all trades, we are completely enthralled that this is happening.
Please come back. We're going to come reconvene here at 4 o'clock. Thank you.